Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I'm gonna go ahead and call this meeting to order. This is the May meeting for the Valhalla County Zoning Board of Appeals. For those of you that may have never been to one of our meetings, let me explain how we operate so you can keep up with us. I will call each case with by case number and case name. Staff can either come to the lectern or if they wish to present from the table to my left, they can do that. But staff will present the case. Once staff has presented the case, there will be more than likely questions and discussions among the board members and back and forth to staff. Once we're satisfied, we understand what is being requested, then I will ask if the applicant or someone who may represent the applicant is here and wishes to speak. If so, please come to the lectern, give us your name and address for the record and whatever information you might want for us to take under consideration. If there are multiple people here in support, we would like to know that you are here. But in the interest of time, because we have several cases and a couple of them could get so long, if your concerns have been brought forward to us, please don't come up here two or three times and hammer with it. One time enough, we can handle. If you feel like something has not been brought to our attention that is important to you, please come to the lectern, give us your name and address for the record and the information that you wish for us to take under advice. Again, there will probably, possibly be questions and or discussions among the board members or back and forth to whoever may be at the lectern at this time. Once we're satisfied that we have heard that side of the presentation, then I will ask if there are any persons here in opposition or if there are any persons here that have questions about what is being requested. If so, please come to the lectern, give your name and address for the record. Give us the information if you want us to take under advisement or ask us the questions that you may feel you need answered. When you have presented that case or that part of it, again, it could be discussion, questions. If there are multiple people in opposition, we want you to have a chance to have your say. If your concerns have already been voiced, please understand we heard it the first time. If you feel like something has not been adequately brought to our attention, please come to the lectern and give us the information that you wish for us to take under advisement. Please give us the information, whether pro or con, as concisely and completely as you can, so that we don't end up with a rebuttal and then re-rebuttal and back and forth. Try to give it to me the first time as best you can. It is normally our position that we make the decision here today based on the information presented. If the board feels like parties need to talk or questions are not adequately answered, we do have the right in our bylaws to postpone action until the next regularly scheduled meeting. Rarely does that happen, but it can happen. Okay, the first thing I need to announce, the City of Valdosta case, application 2018-03, Federal Health and Advantage Permits. That case has been tabled until the June meeting.
They have requested tabling.
Okay, well, I'm getting there, but thank you for correcting me. Yeah. But anyway, the applicant has requested to be tabled until the next regularly scheduled meeting, which will be the first Tuesday in June. Would I get a motion to accept that request?
Make a motion to table.
I have a motion to table. I have a second. All in favor, raise a hand. Okay. If you are here for that case, nothing will transact today. We will hear it next month, first Tuesday in June at 2:30. Okay, next case, Lowndes County case, VAR 2018-08, Graham, 4544 Lock Laurel Road, Valdosta. Ms. Carmella, you have the floor.
Yes, sir. If you don't mind, I can present here. Okay. Okay, with the board.
I would rather have you there because then the camera can see. Then the video, everybody else is not here in the world.
Good afternoon. Our first case, or second case on the agenda, is a request by Mr. William T. Brown. This is a request for variance to the ULDC as it pertains to our access and lot frontage requirement. The property consists of about 2.5 acres and is located at 4544 Lock Law Road in R1 zoning district. As you can see, the subject property is landlocked. Subject property was part of a 30-acre plus estate for which the applicant was appointed the administrator in 1993. The estate was divided, as you see, those other landlocked parcels by the administrator of the estate. It created two things. A deed was created. The lots did not meet our minimum lot size requirement, which was 5 acres at that time. And it did not meet our lot frontage requirement, which requires every lot of the division to have its own frontage on the county maintained road. The deeds were subsequently recorded. There was a survey done. The survey was not reviewed or recorded. And hence, you know, years later, you know, we are addressing the situation. In reviewing this variance request, our primary concern is that of public safety, that is adequate access to the property for emergency services. As you can see, there is on the survey an easement that was agreed upon by the descendants of the estate that they will have a 50-foot ingress and egress easement, and I believe that survey is in your staff report. All the heirs agreed to that, and that is the way the applicant currently accesses this property. Overall, TRC didn't have an issue with this variance request and concurs that the request does not adversely affect the area, the neighborhood, and we are recommending approval.
Okay, the first question I'd like to ask, and it is purely technical.
Yes, sir.
The paperwork that I have in my packet shows what appears to be 8 parcels. The description calls for 9, and the map that was on the picture up there has 7.
Yes, sir.
Is there a technical, any kind of a question or a problem in here that we need to be aware of, or is that just the way it's drawn and just not presented as 9 lots?
Yes, sir. Appreciate that question. The variance is only affecting this parcel, this 2.54 acres. I did get an inquiry from some of the family members who we look forward for them coming back to just fix all of the lots that were created by these. At this time, we're only considering that second parcel in this variance. If that answers the question.
Okay, so to the right of what you have highlighted is another parcel of very similar or same size. Okay, so it's a drawing kind of a thing.
Yes, sir.
Okay, any questions, any discussion from anybody else?
The parcel on the very front that fronts Lock Laurel and goes around behind all the additional lots, L-shaped,
yes.
Is that owned by the same family?
That was one of the descendants. She, because she owned the property to the south, she just combined her 2.5 with the rest of her property.
But she does own the portion that is directly fronting Lock Laurel.
That's correct.
All right, another thing, the road, can you go back to the picture?
Sure.
Where the vehicle is, that's not the easement road.
No.
That's the driveway to the blue house.
That's correct.
Okay, are they going to make a road? I know there's a 50-foot easement on paper, but is there going to be a gravel road, paved road of some description for emergency vehicles?
There are no plans in place to improve that easement to gravel or rock or anything like that.
Don't you have to have a road, a set road for emergency vehicles if you're going to, say, the lot in question that's on the market when it sells, if somebody wants to build a house, there's got to be a designated road?
That's not a requirement, it's a preference. The fire department in this case, because it's unfettered, you know, it's clear, they feel comfortable that they can get to each and every one of those properties in case of emergency.
Just
just to clarify what the chairman said, we're going to see seven more of these.
Yes, or I suggested one application for all seven parcels.
Any other questions, discussion? Thank you, Carmella. Is the applicant here or possibly somebody representing the applicant and would give us any additional information?
Yes, I'm William Graham. Could you go back to your, I think I can clarify something. I think your question, this is the lot in question here, which is the lot.
Right.
I was the administrator for, we call this the Bullyboro Shire. We originally had 300 acres here, and then once it was divided, once my grandmother passed away, we had had the property since 1949. And when she passed away, then it was divided so that each of the children who stayed home got 30 acres. And this was Willie Crow's 30 acres. She died as an unmarried woman with no children. And so that was in 1953. I was 10 years old at the time. And I became the administrator in 1993. It showed nothing had been done. So when my mother passed away, then I took on the task of dividing these lots up so that each of the original nine children's heirs would receive some portion of it. This lot that you, this section that you were questioning about here on Locklaw Road, I could have given the lot to anyone, but what I decided to do was there were two families who were continuing to farm here. I gave them first preference. And she was, the lady who owns it now is Laverne Carter. But at that time, she was married to my uncle, who passed away. And at that time, she was Laverne Shire, I'm sorry. But she's now Laverne Carter. She remarried. And so she just joined hers up to the 30 acres that they had. And so that's the reason why it's not showing here in green. But I could have taken it myself, but I decided to give each person who was still living there first preference, and that was our husband, W. A. Shire, that was his first preference. And the other person was Richard Shire, and I gave him the back section there, because that was his preference, since they were living there.
All right.
And Mrs. Braswell and I had two or three meetings. The first one didn't go too well. She read me all of the zoning code and a little bit of the Riot Act and told me I couldn't get anything. And the second meeting, I decided that I need to go to my garage and dig out some dusty old paintbrushes and whatnot. It turns out she came to the conclusion before I did that we had gone this route 20 years earlier. But the difference was that I didn't have gray hair at that time, and she was named Braswell. She was Miss Carter at that time. But I showed her signature on the papers and all, that we had agreed that I would always have access to that lot by means of Locklaw Road. And I believe she had the documentation in your packet. And she can verify that at that point. We did go a couple of rounds.
Not a problem. Okay. Anything else you would like for us to be aware of?
No, just really appreciate your consideration or my application there.
Any questions, any comments, any discussion? Thank you, sir. Is there anyone else here in support or would like to speak? Is there anyone here in opposition to this request or has questions about what is being requested? I don't know, was there any response to your office on this case that we need to be aware of?
Yes, sir, there was a couple calls from family members, just wanted to know, you know, why we're doing this. I thought this was taken care of, but nothing in opposition to this case request.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, any other discussion, any questions for Carmella before I ask the question? Can I get a motion on this request?
I make a motion to approve the variance as presented.
I have a motion on the floor from Ms. Portland to grant the request as presented, citing criteria D. Is there a second? And a second from Nancy. All in favor, please raise a hand. Good luck with it, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, the next case we will listen to is VAR 2018-09. Indo American Cultural Society of South Georgia, 2117 West Side Road, Valdosta. Ms. Bradley, you have the floor.
Yes, sir. This is a request by Indo American Cultural Society of South Georgia. They are requesting two variances as it pertains to bump yards and landscaping for parking lots. So the property consists of 12 and a half acres. It is located at 2117 West Side Road in an R1 zoning district. Religious facilities are allowed by right in R1 zoning district as long as you can follow the standards. As you can see from your table, there is a buffer requirement, and if you look at each one of your stations, I put a schematic where church is required to provide a 20-foot wide buffer along their east lot line from the road all the way down and over. So that's my variance that they're requesting. And they are also required to provide landscaping within their parking lot area. Because of the type of improvement they're using gravel instead of your traditional asphalt concrete. They're requesting a relief to not landscape at all. In this case. Staff looked at the request and we somewhat agree and can understand the reason for relief of the buffer. As you can see on the east lot line, there is an access easement that goes the entire length of the property for which these two residences use to get to their property. So we feel that the buffer yard is somewhat ineffective. Plus the fact that on this property, at least 3 acres of this property, it's been delineated as wetlands, which they can't develop anyway.
Can you show where the access easement is located?
Not that tall, but on that schematic it will show, but it runs the length of the property on the side.
If you would go back to the picture before that, it shows where the car was. That's the easement that's going up through that property. Right. And it's supposed to be a 30-foot road.
And 60.
We had 50 or 60. Mm-hmm. And right now it's not 60 foot. Okay. So,
did that answer your question? It did. Thank you.
So staff understanding that there's an easement there, staff want that easement to continue to be open so the residents can use that to get to their property. So we are recommending approval with some conditions. On your schematic where you see the yellow areas, which would be along this area, and then up towards the west side, we are recommending approval. We are recommending an undisturbed buffer in those orange areas that surrounds the house, around this house. We're requesting that he total buffers this area because on the aerial you can see where there's very limited vegetation behind the house. So we're recommending approval of the following conditions. The existing vegetation along the exterior of map 0087, parcel 220, that abuts the subject property shall remain undisturbed. And again, that's that reddish orange color on your schematic. condition number two, that a buffer yard shall be required along the property line of tax map 0087, parcel 219. That's that greenish color that you see on the schematic. And lastly, we recommend the condition that we require internal landscaping for the proposed parking lot to consist of 1,535 square feet plus three trees be relocated elsewhere on the lot, preferably closest to the building, the religious facility that's being proposed. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Okay, so what you are requesting for that item three, where are you, for their knowledge and ours, where are you talking about requesting that?
We left it up to him to tell us, but we would like it located somewhere around the proposed religious facility.
Down close to the building, as opposed to being
in the park
out there somewhere.
Yes, sir.
Carmella, is there any variance being requested for the buffer along the school property?
There's no buffer required.
No buffer required. And then what was the yellow? What's the recommendation of staff on the yellow and the northwest part?
That be relieved. Totally relieved. That's the fire department and their representative. They didn't have an issue, and they're going to use that side of the property to bring down all their utilities.
Any other questions or discussions?
I do have a question. Not exactly relevant, but how did that house end up there without any frontage on a road crazy with this lot coming like a little skinny arm beside it? How did that get there?
Actually, the subject property wraps around that.
That's what I mean. How did that get carved up like that with that little crazy arm on it?
I couldn't tell you when that lot was created. That's something I can research. I would think it was created by the it was created.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions, discussion? Thank you, Carmella. Is there anyone here with this group that would like to speak? Please go to the left and circle with your name and address for the record.
This is my neighbor. This is,
sir,
my property, right?
Yes, sir. Did I get your name and address
for the record? Oh, Robert Butler, 2103 West Hagel.
Thank you.
This is my property here. This is my neighbor's property. That is a 60-foot easement running from West Side Road. He was in the project that said, this is the landline for the American Cut or whatever it's supposed to be. And what are they going to put a parking lot with nothing else there? This is what I'm, it's the subject here about a parking lot, right?
Well, when they talk about putting in a parking lot, that triggers the requirement that they must do some landscaping and create a buffer. And what they're requesting is that some of that be relieved so they don't have to do it. And that's what they're asking.
Who is they?
All of the Indo-American Cultural Society of South Georgia.
Most of this is wetland. They dug in there once before. And they had to get out. I don't know who made them go, but they had to stop. So I am in opposition of them not digging anymore in here, because the water, when they dig or cover this wetland, all that water backs back this way.
based on the, what is being requested here, they are not proposing to do anything into that area. This is all going to be on the perimeter.
Mr. Strickland, is he speaking for or in opposition to this variance? Is anybody here to speak for it? They have an opportunity to...
Well, I asked, were the people, I asked if there's anyone here for. I thought you were in for them.
Okay,
hold on a minute, excuse me. Is there anyone here on behalf of Indo-American Cultural Society of South Georgia that would like to speak and give us any information? Okay. Opposition, you now have the floor. I thought you were with them, and then when you started asking the questions, it became clear that you were opposed.
But I am, and my neighbor, in opposition of them not interfering with my, with our easement, because of the vegan.
Okay. Hang on 1 second. Carmelo, can you back it up one or two so we can see the actual areas that we're talking about? Yeah, okay. Sir, that big oval that's up in the middle of the picture,
right.
They are not proposing to do anything in that area, and because it is a wetlands area, if they do anything in there, they're probably going to have permission from the Corps of Engineers before they do anything. If they start digging in there without their permission, they're going to get their hands popped pretty good. What they're talking about doing is up in the upper left, that yellow spot up on the upper left, and then the shaded area that's coming down the right side. Right, they're talking about building the building, but right now, what we're talking about, what the request is the colored spot.
This is a proposed building.
That green, they're proposed to build it. They are proposing to build this building in that parking lot. In order to do that, they have to meet buffering and landscaping requirements. They are asking to be relieved of some of the requirements, and the county is requesting that some of them be relieved, some of them not be relieved. And what they're asking for, what the county has suggested, is that they will do the buffering, I'm sorry, the yellow part up there will be totally ignored. There will not be anything up there. Correct, Carmelo?
That's correct.
The green that's coming across to the side of your neighbor, they're saying they want to increase some of that. The shaded sort of gray area that's wrapping around your property, there's going to be no change in that area, correct?
That's correct.
And then the greenish yellow that goes back to the right and up above back to the west side road, there will be some buffer requirements there.
No buffer.
I'm sorry. No buffer. And none of this is going to affect the easement that the two of you have coming in. That is a proper recorded easement. They can't interfere with that easement. And so you and your neighbor will not be interfered with on that. Please come to the lectern, give us your name and address for the record.
Okay. My name is Freeman Hunter, 2452 Danny Road. I live in that area, and the easement is going up through there. Okay? Now, they asked me 5 or 4 years ago when we first started, would we be willing to give them that easement and they were going to pave us on the other side? And I told them, no. This is what I asked you, Mr. Carmelo, if you don't mind, would you go back to where the car's parked one or 2 years? Okay. Now here, this is where we turn in to go up to our house. Okay. This is the wetland here. When the water, when it rains real good, it messes up that road. We got holes in it. Just to bring the question I want to ask you guys. What are your rules and regulations about getting that road? You're a taxpayer. Now, what about getting that road paved? What can we do about that?
Okay. Okay.
The county engineer.
Yeah, the county engineer would be the one to determine that, but correct me if I'm wrong, Carmella, but this is an easement.
Okay.
It is not county property.
Okay.
Because it is an easement, I don't think the county can put money into it because it's not a county road. It's gonna fall to the property owners that control that easement to fix whatever they need to do on the road, but that's a question you need to go to Lowndes County Engineering Department.
Okay, yeah, we'll be asking about that.
But what we're discussing here will not affect that easement in any way.
Okay, now there's one more question that I have. I don't want you guys, having this particular point, I'm not, but, this area, all the way back up to West Side, all right, and that road, they're charging us on our taxes, school tax, park recreation, and street tax. You don't have any street lights up in our area here, you don't have a park out there, and we don't have, that school tax.
Okay, sir, that's something to be taken up with the county commissioners and the tax office.
Okay.
That's something we can't control, have no control.
Anyway, that road, now, you were saying, they're gonna come up this side, and that's where you're gonna be at the church and the parking lot.
Not over side.
It's gonna be on the other side of the wetland, down there next to you.
Yeah, right in front of the house.
Very funny.
And they did look swamp.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, that's.
Yeah, that's swamp.
Yes, ma'am.
If I may, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Oh, yeah, I have you too.
Okay.
Is this the button?
This is you.
And they gonna put the parking lot next to the church, you said?
Yeah, parking lot is going in front of the church, close to the north side.
Okay, well, that's a question.
Did that answer your question, sir?
Yes, sir.
Did that answer your question?
Very well.
I have one more question. What is the problem? What's that mean?
Carmella, I'm gonna leave you, give the legal description or whatever.
A buffer yard is an area that's reserved where you have to plant so many trees, so many shrubs every 100 feet.
It's to screen whatever is being on the commercial side, or in this case, the church side, from private property. The ULDC says you have to screen it in some way, and they call it a buffer. Is there anyone else here in opposition?
Other questions? What do we have for the questions? Who will we come to talk to after?
Sir, if you have questions, you need to present them now. Because once we decide here, once we make whatever decision is made, there's not much you can do except appeal it beyond that, because once we make this decision, it's pretty much done. And what they're proposing to do, specifically in your property, they're going to increase the vegetative trees and shrubs between you and this proposed church, that green spot. Try to give you some privacy from them and them some privacy from you. That's what the buffer is for. There's going to be no real change for your neighbor's property. There's going to be no real change going up the side where the easement comes in. And whatever they're talking about doing will not affect your easement in any shape, form, or fashion.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Give me a second, ma'am. Do y'all have any other questions or discussions?
I don't.
All right, Nancy.
Did we not recently pass, something where the applicant has to be here? Are we tabling? I mean, we don't have an applicant here to ask questions to.
There was some discussions, but I don't know that we decided the applicant absolutely had to be. I don't recall us deciding that they had to be.
I haven't passed any policy to that effect, but there was definitely discussion.
And if.
No, why the applicant is not here?
No, he was sent this out for, I mean, the things.
All right. We also have on the table, so to speak, we can have a motion to postpone till the next regular scheduled meeting and ask Carmella to notify these people that they ought to be here for the continuation of the hearing. The other side of the coin is we've got people here, made time to come, now we're going to make them come back a second time. So it's sort of a judgment of the ball, you know, which way we want to go, but it is within the authority of this board. If the board wants to postpone it or table it till the next digital meeting, we can.
It just seems like the opposition may have some questions that only the advocate might be able to give them some assurance on.
Possibly. Based on that, gentlemen, do you feel like the most part of your concerns have been addressed, or do you feel like you still have concerns?
Right now, I'm pretty much satisfied in what I've heard. I don't have a lot of problems. I understand what's going on.
And you, sir?
Oh, well, you said what on this board decide. Right now, here today, and past, that's what it is. Now, if the other, what you call it, opposition, whoever, now here, you're saying not, but you could table that and come back on in another meeting.
That is a possibility. If we table it, that means there will be no action taken today.
Okay.
What I'm saying is, if this board makes a motion, accepts that motion, votes to take it, then it becomes, that is the group, that's what's going to happen. If anybody, either side, does not like what happened, then you have or they have the right to appeal it to Carmella's office. If she says it's not appealable, then you have to go within 30 days of getting copy of the ruling, the minutes of the ruling. At that point, then you would have to seek legal counsel and address it in the courts, because that's the next step. Once we decide here, then that is what's going to happen. That's the law, but we are technically adjusting the ULDC regulations for this parcel. And once we do that, then it's a done deal.
And I think you pretty much answered the next question I asked. I would say if you did, and somebody wanted to appeal it, you would have to get a copy of whatever paperwork, and within 30 days.
Within 30,
you have to next, would that
with,
be?
Within 30 days of the minutes being completed, it takes a week, 10 days, whatever, to complete the meeting minutes, at which point you would request a copy of the meeting minutes. And you can then, if you wish, you can go talk to Carmella and tell her you want to appeal. And it may or may not be appealable to us, probably won't be, but you definitely have the right to appeal it to Superior Court.
Okay, I have no problem not going to appeal it, but I just wondered if you table it, how many days, weeks, months would you come back to another meeting?
If we table it, then the first Tuesday in June, we will meet back here in this same room.
Okay.
there may or may not be somebody from the Indo-American culture. And at that point, it's up to this board to decide whether they will grant what they're requesting, whether they will deny what they're requesting, or whether it's within the power of this board to adjust what the board feels like is fair between the two, between what they're asking and nothing. Okay, Nancy, did that appease anything?
Don't answer my question, there's my vote. I have one more question.
Yes.
This property is zoned, what is the zoning on this property?
R1.
And the property along the east, that long piece, not the school, but on the other side, where we're going to, where we're talking about giving them relief on the very long side.
Okay.
What's that neighbor?
R1.
R1. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions, any other discussion from the board?
One vote.
Is there any, can the county do anything about noise level in that area when they, if
that would be something you would take up with code enforcement. If and when it comes to the problem. Okay. No further questions, no further discussion. Can I get a motion on this request of some description?
Make a motion to table this request from last time.
I have a motion on the floor from this board of month to table this case until the next regularly scheduled meeting, which is the June, whatever date it is, the first Tuesday in June, with the advisor that Carmella, would you please make an attempt to get some information to these folks that they need to be here before that meeting?
Yes, sir.
Is that okay with that? Is there a second? I have a second. All in favor, raise a hand. 1, 2, 3. All opposed? Or do not vote?
I voted.
Okay. Okay, so we got 4-3. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 3 again. So we passed.
Will those opposed raise their hands once I vote? Gotcha.
It's going to be tabled until the next regular scheduled meeting, which will be the first Tuesday in June. Gentlemen, you will be advised again, but you need to put it on your calendar, the first Tuesday in June, 2:30, right here in this room, and we will attempt to render a decision at that time.
Thank you. And one other thing I was going to say real quick is those questions that you had about the dirt road, you probably want to address that for a meeting. Of course, the concerns you had about the potholes in the road and everything, you may want to address that before the meeting. Yes, sir.
But that's, you're going to have to take that up with the county, not with the zoning board.
Thank you.
Okay, next case we're called is VAR 2018-10, Rock Laurel Club, Rock Laurel Road, Valdosta.
Yes, sir. This is a request for some variances to the ODC supplemental standards as it pertains to outdoor recreation facilities, specifically the standards dealing with setbacks and yards. Subject property consists of 228 acres. Is located at the intersection of Lock Laurel Road and Dash Hills Road in an R8 zoning district. Outdoor recreation facilities are permitted within the R8 zoning, as long as you can follow the standards. In this case, we have Lock Laurel Club that was established many, many years ago, prior to any zoning regulations or land use regulations. So what we have is a non-conforming use. They can continue to operate as a club, but they cannot do any improvements, they can't grow it, can't
expanded, kind of stuck with that. So they're requesting three variances. The first variance is a variance to the minimum setback for outdoor recreation areas. What staff has determined is the pond is their one of their primary sources for outdoor recreation. And there are certain areas of the pond that falls within 150 feet. There's a schematic in the staff report that the applicant drew for us, has been red marked. Those are the areas that we determined that do not meet that 150-foot setback requirement. The second variance deals with the buffer, minimum buffer yard. As you look at the table, the minimum buffer is increased 1.5 times the normal. So in that case, they're required to provide a 45-foot buffer. Within that buffer, you have to plant so many trees, so many shrubs. In that case, that would require them to take down some things in order to plant some things, and we just didn't feel that was effective nor necessary in this case. And lastly, they're requesting a variance to the non-conforming provisions that says that any variance authorized by the Zoning Board of Appeals for which construction has not commenced within 1 year from the date on which the decision of the ZBA becomes final shall be deemed abandoned. Well, in this case, you know, there is a potential for others who are club members to build their homes. We just don't know when, at what point they will build. And there are some instances where the existing homes, they may want to add an addition, for which we had something similar to happen a year ago. We just don't know. The staff just feels real comfortable in the establishment of the club. It's self-monitored. It has functioned, you know, without any problems for many, many years. And as such, staff is recommending approval for all variances. With regards to the minimum setback, we are recommending approval. With regards to the minimum buffer, we are recommending approval with one condition. That condition being that vegetation along the exterior boundaries of the property remain undisturbed. Meaning, you know, what we see, just keep it, leave it alone, it's mature, you know, just let it be for a width at least 45 feet. And we're also recommending approval on the expiration of variance. We've been working with the applicant for about a year on which process was better for them because they don't have plans. They don't have any definite plans of who's going to do what. But, you know, they are very careful. They are very, how shall I say it, close-knit club. And we feel comfortable with that.
Any questions, any discussions from board?
Okay. What was the last one that y'all recommended approval on? I got the buffer and the setback. What was the last one?
The minimum setback.
No, I got the setback and the buffer and there was
the third one. And then the third one is the expiration of variance
approvals. I'm a little confused about that last one. Mm-hmm. We're giving a variance for setback and buffer. So I don't see how the buffer could expire. How could the buffer, they're not doing anything to the buffer, so how could that expire?
Well, we're recommending that they leave it undisturbed. They can't do anything with it from this point going forward. An undisturbed buffer is what we would like to see.
Okay. And the setback has to do with they're going to build some different buildings that don't meet the setback.
That may not meet the 150 feet. Primarily the pond. We don't see anything going on the east side of the pond, and the applicant is here to confirm that. But we're requesting a variance.
I don't understand why we're doing this expiration thing. Why you have no expiration?
There may, 2 years, maybe 5 years from now, one of the club members may want to build a house. And we don't want the variance you know, the code says you don't do anything within a year from the date, from this date, your variance.
But how, what variance are we giving them that would a building of a house on that property would be involved? We're giving them a setback and a buffer. So how would building a house be, have anything to do? I'm really confused.
In the future, we don't want any of our rules to stop them or enable them to not build anything else or improve on that property. If we don't grant that 1 year expiration of variance to that, then they have to come back to us if 2 years from now they want to build a house.
Because they're non-conforming.
Because they're non-conforming.
Is it then because of the pond? Is the pond the problem? That's what violates the buffer setback and the...
Right, the pond, 3/4 of the pond, you pretty much can't build around it anyway. It's pretty wet, there's not much room around it. So anything that they're going to build is going to be generally between 9 o'clock and 5 o'clock or whatever, if you're looking at it like it is, because the rest of it, there's not enough land there and it's generally low.
I have another question. I'm still really confused. Does this free them completely from building requirements? Like, say somebody's going to build an addition on their house. That was an example that you gave.
Mm-hmm.
Are they free from all the standards to buildings?
No, ma'am. They still have to follow those standards.
Okay, but right now they couldn't build any addition on their house because they're not conforming.
That is correct.
But so this says, even though you're not conforming, you can still do something, but you have to meet all the other standards. Okay, I got it.
Any other questions, discussions? Thank you, Carmella. We may call on you again.
Thank you.
Is there anyone here from Rock Laurel Club that would like to give us some additional information, any additional insight?
I am Pierce Scott, 916 Crown Reef, Colorado. I am the president of the Rock Laurel Club, and I'm here with Bruce Smith today too. He's a member of the club, a board member, and an architect. And he was the one who was actually trying to expand it, make an addition, slight addition to his home, which started this process. So we are really here to just make ourselves available for questions. I think Carmelo did a good job of presenting. I'll try to clarify a few things in the beginning and then give you a chance to ask other questions. But to make it clear, the only non-conformance is this part up here, the back slope, or back side of the lake there. The non-conformance is simply that the lake itself is not at least 150 feet from the property line. It can't be, because we only have 20 feet above high water mark, as high as the property goes. And so it's impossible for us to comply with that particular requirement. And it was one of these houses here that Bruce was just making an addition of about 2 feet to, that ran into a problem. He was unable to get the approval for that, because of what we consider to be a technical nonconformance on the far side of the lake. Nothing he was doing was nonconforming, but it was because the lake itself was considered nonconforming. That's why, as my understanding is why, he did not get a building permit to begin with. And again, talking with Carmel about it, and eventually he was allowed to do that with the understanding that we as a club would come back for you and ask for variance, so that in the future, if we decide to build, if the member does decide to build, we won't run into the same thing again. And with respect to your question about the 1 year, my understanding is that the regulation says that if we don't begin construction within a year after the variance is granted, then we lose it. We deem to have abandoned it. And because we don't know if we'll be building or adding on another year, then we probably won't. But we didn't want to be stuck with going through this whole process and pay for it and so forth, and then not build for a year, and then 2 years from now say, come and say, well, you're still in non-compliance, we have to go through the same process again. So that's the reason we asked for that.
But once we grant the variance, then we're in compliance. Because if they're not building something, we're just saying, yeah, the lake's too close to the property line. So it should, there shouldn't be the issue of expiration. What we're doing is bringing them into compliance. So expiration isn't an issue.
I'd like to.
You'll get a chance.
It is, in the fact that if they got it granted to that, they won't be done for a year, and then they'd have to come back and pay a reapplication fee.
That's what I understand.
Because they're going to be non-conforming forever, because the lake can never be close enough, but we're granting them a variance, and the variance lasts forever on how close you are. When we grant a variance on setback, that stays with the property forever, no matter who owns it, no matter what else is on there. So we're granting a variance to the setback of this property, stays with that property, that's now in compliance. It's no longer non-conforming. It's compliant.
I would rather address the technicality at this point, just in case I'm not here a year from now, that whoever is in that position, you know, is done and it's on record. But I understand what you're saying.
But we would then have to apply this extra variance to every single property that we give a setback to say, you have your setback forever. That seems redundant. When we give the setback, it goes with the property forever.
And it just may take just a text amendment for us to either tweak that language. It was there for a reason. It's there for a reason.
Well, it's there when they're building something. So if you're getting a variance to your setback and it's because you're building something that you're getting that variance. Because you're going to build an addition that's going to be too close to your neighbor. If you don't begin building that thing. That, they're not building anything. They're getting a variance to the setback because the lake is too close to the water. It's completely different.
If we could either an exemption from that or a recognition that that particular rule does not apply in this situation, I think either one would give us what we need. I'm just reading the language. It says any variance authorized by the board for which construction is not commenced with one year from the date of the decision shall be deemed abandoned, void, and no further force and effect. So that's the reason that we wanted to address that and make sure that we won't be stuck again in 2 years from now with the same technical non-compliance. And that's what we're trying to cover. And the other reason is we put a letter in there from the county manager that said basically made even Bruce's expansion contingent upon us coming before the board to get a variance. Are there any other questions?
Any other questions? Any other comments? Is there anyone else here in support who would like to speak?
I'd like to just say one thing.
I think we've already got it.
I want to make one more point that I think will help some of you understand why we're concerned about the timeline of the 1 year and it avoiding that. 1 year. My name is Bruce Smith. I'm in 2941 Lock Hall Road. One of the concerns that we've been told is if one of the existing structures were to be damaged through fire, lightning, a tree fall on it, we would not be issued a permit until we go through this process. That leaves someone's structure exposed for further weather damage. We'd be, you know, at least a 2-month process in getting approval just to get a permit to rebuild or repair. So that's one of the concerns we have about this clause in the ULDC, that if we don't start construction within a year, we lose this variance. Well, then in 2 years, if we decide to do something or something happens to one of the existing structures, we're right back here. We're spending application money. We're going through a process that we've really already been through.
And really, that's the lake. There was a question asked, any future development, will it be held to the ULDC? Yes, we will still have to meet all setbacks for any future buildings. Any of that, we understand we have to go through the process. It's purely we're trying to get relief on that north and north eastern side of the property where the property line has been what it is for over 100 years. There's nothing we can do about it. We can't move the lake. The ULDC was written after the property line was developed for this piece of property. So that's why we're a little concerned about the terminology in the ULDC about if we don't build within a year, then we lose our variance. We just don't want to have to go through a 2-month process just to get a building permit in the event one of the existing structures would be damaged or destroyed.
And correct me, possibly legal, if the board deemed it okay to do the minimum setback and the minimum buffer and not exercise the expiration of the variance approval, because we're dealing with one large parcel, there's not in the individual parcels, they're individual buildings on the parcel, but they're not individual lots. So, is there a way, I guess where I'm going is there a way to leave the buffer and the setback variances on the northern and eastern sides where it is a problem? But they still, if something happened, like you talked about, if there was a fire, a lightning strike, tree fell, or somebody just decided, okay, the club's okay, I could build another little place for me to go on the weekend. We're not dealing with the setback on the far side from that house. We're dealing with the setback of the lake to the lake. And, you know, you see where I'm going?
Yes, sir.
Is that going to create a huge headache if the board were to deem okay one, okay two, and not three? And that's
any
where you're
new
going.
House will have to meet the supplemental standard.
Well, each and every house, in addition, whatever, we still have to meet everything for the supplemental standards. You'd have to have the permit process to go through for them to give a building permit, repair permit, whatever. But they would then not have to appeal back to us or the north and the eastern end of the lake, which is really not anything to do with the house that they're trying to do with. It's out there.
Right. We're just talking about the setback of the lake, which doesn't have anything to do with building. And yes, okay, they're not conforming. They're going to come into conformance because we're going to give them this variance. Then whenever they want to get their house fixed up or add an addition, the setback is completely irrelevant. The timeline doesn't matter anymore.
My question. I mean, I don't want to create more problems down the road than we're solving.
And I don't want to set a precedent where we're making these be forever. This kind of thing that we do is forever, and I don't want to let off on that 1 year if you're going to actually build something that's in the setback. We need to keep that.
If they are proposing to build house number 15, then we would issue a permit based on the supplemental standards being met. The house would have to be 150 feet from the property line, etc. But the setback has to do with the lake primarily. That is the outdoor recreation one of the PLEs. And then the buffer, you know, if you all relieve the buffer requirement, then that's something else you don't have to worry about because they would have been in compliance when you grant a relief to the buffer. As long as they don't mess with, you know, the 45-foot area around that property, they would be in compliance. So the variance separation, I understand where you're coming from. Once the variance is granted, you know, there is no time limit.
Right.
And if we can agree that 2 years, 3 years from now, they don't have to come back, I'm good with that. I
I'm okay with that. That's one of the goals. They don't have to come back through this process.
Any other questions, any other discussion? No, we haven't had opposition yet. Is there anyone else here in support or would like to speak? Is there anyone here in opposition to what is being requested or has questions about what is being requested? Was there any response to your office card notes?
Yes, there was a number of telephone calls, not necessarily in opposition, just what's going on. You know,
what's the little red sign?
Yes.
Okay. And I'm not going to, I was going to ask something, I'm not going to. Okay. Nancy, do you have something?
No, I'm ready to.
Okay. Can I get a motion on this request? All right, Nancy?
I make a motion to approve, as requested, the variance to the minimum setback, variance to the minimum buffer, conditional on the current buffer, same tag, and the variance to the provision for exploration of the variance approvals, finding criteria D.
Everybody understand? Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second. Ms. Alvarado. All in favor, please raise a hand and hold. Okay, you now.
Thank you all.
Okay, the next case is VAR 2018-11. Lucia Marrero, 5594 Shallow Road, Hayden Howard.
Yes, sir. This is a request for a variance to the side yard setback. Subject property consists of 2 little 2 acres and is located on Shallow Road. This request came about as a code enforcement case. There was a manufactured home placed on the property without any permits or approvals. In your packet, you should see a site plan which shows you the side yard setback encroachment. There's a corner of the home that does not meet the 20-foot setback requirement. It is measured at least 11 feet off the property line, just the corner of the property. Staff looked at this, we were very concerned about this project because a lot of this could have been avoided if the permits were secured. But being that only a corner of the property encroaches upon the setback, we staff is recommending removal of the request with no conditions.
Any questions or discussion?
So this is a second house on one parcel, right?
That is correct. The property does qualify for a second dwelling. There's plenty of room on the property.
It qualifies for second dwelling because there is sufficient acreage. And is this family related or just not?
I believe so. The property on the manufactured home is a family member of the property.
Any other discussion?
And did you say that there wasn't a permit pulled before the mobile home was installed? Is that right?
That is correct. And the applicant is here that can answer.
Do we have a separate septic tank and well for that mobile home?
They will have to have their own septic system. The well, they can probably share the well.
Probably the reason for the septic tank issue is the septic tanks sized by the health department based on the dwellings that are there, and if they tie this into the other one, they may exceed the capacity to go out, and therefore they would need a separate septic tank.
Do we have input from the health department on this?
Thank you, Carmella. Is anyone here in support of this application? And if so, is there anything you'd like to provide with us?
Good evening. I'm Suzanne with Autosta Home Center. I sold the mobile home to the customers, but I am the applicant in this case. All our customers are required to pull their own permits. In this event, our customers did not comply as we were told. So when we got the home out there and got it set, the tree that you see here was placed, mother and daughter, so it is family and they've been there several years. The tree was planted by the applicant's deceased husband, and he has since passed, so they plan on keeping that tree on the property. We tried to accommodate her, or my movers did, by putting the home where they didn't have to cut the tree down. I was not in town at the time when the home was placed, so when I got back and realized that the setbacks were not made, I contacted them and contacted Barbara Herring to get a site plan so I could see exactly where the property lines were. She had no idea. She actually thought that the property lines went about 10 feet further back. So I made them stop. As you can see, it's not finished or anything, to try to figure out where the property lines were. At that point, we figured out that the back corner, the right back corner, is about 11 feet away from the property line. We have about 11 feet there. The sides do meet the requirements on both sides and the back. It's just that one corner, and as you can see on the plot, it's a pie shape. And when I'm reading the permit, I was just going by front, side. I wasn't considering the corner. But we did stop. We have not completed until this process. There is a septic tank that has been installed. If in the event we need to move the home forward, it will still reach, and we put it in a place where the septic tank won't have to be redone. All health department records are there, and I can get them over to you.
Anything else?
Did you say there was an existing septic tank?
There's an existing tank for the current home. We installed one on this side, so we did have to have that inspected by the health department. All that is passed. We have full permits and everything for that already.
So did I understand correctly that the septic tank is in such a place that you could move the house forward 10 feet?
In the event if we had to.
And moving the house forward 10 feet doesn't impact the tree?
The way it was, the daughter said her concern was once they finally got in place, there are multiple wrecks on this road and they end up in her front yard and have multiple times. So when we told her that we may have to move the home forward, they got upset about it, but if we have to do that, then obviously we'll. It will cost about $10,000 to remove this home. It is a three-piece, it's a triple-wide, full drywall residential rooftop home. So in the event that we do, of course, you know, that's what it would take. But yes, the septic tank was put in place so that we could in the event.
Any other questions, discussion?
Is there a fence between the subject property and the adjoining property? Is there any boundary line?
We put boundary stakes up once I had Barbara go out and do that, Barbara Herring do that. But there was an old metal fence we eventually found that had been knocked over and dug up under a lot of roots and trees. There's no residence to this, where this corner meets. It does meet a wooded area back there.
Any other questions? Is there anyone else here in support that would like to speak? Is there anyone here in opposition or anyone here that has a question about what is being requested? Was there any response to your office, Carmella?
Yes, there were a number of phone calls. They concerned, didn't go as far as say they were opposed to the request, but they were very concerned that things weren't done the way it was supposed to be done.
Any other questions, any other discussions before I ask for a motion?
Did you hear anything from the adjoining owner on the east side of the property?
Yes, if his name is Mr. Webb, yes, he did come into the office and wanted to get clarification on what was being requested. He thought the home was more closer than what the site plan depicted. But he didn't state any opposition. He was just concerned.
Is there a minimum lot size for RA?
Yes, 2.5 acres.
So there would be no way that they could carve this mobile home office a separate piece of it?
Not without a zoning or rezoning.
Any other discussions? Can I entertain a motion on this request?
I'll make a motion. I'd like to make a motion that we grant the variance request as presented, site and staff recommendations with no condition.
Citing?
With no condition.
No.
Criteria D, I'm sorry.
Now, motion on the floor to grant as presented, citing criteria D. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second, Mr. Alvarado. All in favor, raise a hand. All opposed? Two opposed. Good luck with it.
Thank you.
Next case is VAR 2018-12, Ramos, 2703 Highway 41 South, Round Oxford.
Yes, sir. Our next request is a variance to the Lyons County ODC Supplemental Standards as it pertains to vehicle repair shops. Subject property consists of 1.4 acres. It's located at 2703 US Highway 41 South and CH zoning district. As you can see, the property is already developed, has been unoccupied for about 2 years. The property was developed prior to the ODC having standards, and the business closed in 2008, which is after the standard. So time has passed, so much time has passed, but the regulations are triggered, so he wants to go back and open back up. As you can see from the standards, he doesn't meet our buffer requirements. He's required to buffer the property to the north and to the east. Staff looked at this. We're generally satisfied with leaving the buffer yard, given the proposed reuse of the property, given the location of the existing building, the existing chain link fence, and the probability of future commercial zoning in the area. The applicant who's present today did receive letters of support from his adjacent property owner, and they were not in opposition to the variance request. As such, we'll recommend approval of the request with no conditions.
Any questions or discussions from anyone? Thank you, Carmella. Is there anyone here on behalf of the applicant or would like to speak for the applicant?
John Forsley, Forswell, Terrace Boulevard. I'm just here with the applicant to answer any questions on my part. So, we are here.
Anything you want to add beyond that?
I think my mother did a good job. She did say that it's been closed in 2008, but Mr. Ramos has operated out there just without the business license.
Any questions, any discussion? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone here in opposition or has a question about what's being requested? You've already said that you had, or the applicant had letters from adjacent property owners. Was there any contact with your office in the negative?
No, sir.
None. Ladies and gentlemen, any other questions or discussions? Can I entertain a motion on this request?
I'll make the motion.
I have a motion on the floor. Do I have a second?
Yeah. I made a motion that we grant the variance as presented, cite the staff recommendations and also cite criteria D.
Sorry about that. I'm just trying to hurry this along. Do I have a second? I have a second, Nancy. All in favor, please raise your hand. Unanimous. Good luck with it. Thank you very much. Okay. The next item on the agenda ADD 2018-01, Cochran, for 5310 Tucker Road, Valdosta. Tell you what, Carmella, give us a second, let these people leave, and then we'll jump on this.
So our final request is a request for an appeal to an administrative action as it pertains to home occupations. So the property consists of 12 and a half acres and is located at 5310 Tucker Road in an EA zoning district. The board called a variance a couple of months ago by the owner of 5310 Tucker Road, requesting variances to our home occupation standards. That variance, or both variances, were ultimately denied. So the applicant is required to follow the standards of our home occupation. Section 10 of the ODC provides that appeals to the Zoning Board of Appeals may be filed by any person aggrieved by any written interpretation of the county manager, TRC, or designated administrative official, based or made on the enforcement of the UODC. In this case, the applicant has appealed to the Zoning Board of Appeals on an action made by the Lancaster County Zoning Office to approve an occupation tax registration for the business establishment, model septic tanks, and portable toilets to operate as a home occupation at 5310 Tucker Road. As defined in the UODC, home occupations are any business or profession customarily conducted entirely within a dwelling and carried on by an occupant thereof, which use is clearly incidental and secondary to the use of the dwelling for residential purposes. The UODC goes further on to list several types of different types of home occupation and allows for an interpretation to be made for those unlisted home occupations that are similar in tax. The Lowndes County Zoning Office has been challenged with the opportunity to make decisions concerning the application of the UODC. And those can be very challenging at times. As explained to the applicant, there are times when our office have to make interpretations. And in this case, we did just that, made an interpretation that the business meet the requirements of a home occupation. Over time, staff has tweaked and amended the provisions of the UODC as it pertains to home occupation. Over time, we've seen a number of business applications to be conducted out of the home that are not customarily as an attorney or a doctor or an accountant. Over the years, we've seen businesses start up with various types, from your lawn service person to your plumber to your handyman, etc. In this case, Milo's portable toilet is one of those occupations that just, you know, falls in that unlisted category, in our opinion. The consent of applications are reviewed by our office. We had to process an average of about 224 business applications a year. And I would say over 50%, maybe close to 60% of the applications reviewed are all home occupations. So they vary from time to time, with very few complaints from neighbors. As such, staff has attempted to provide some responses to the standards for home occupations. As you can see in the outline in the pages, I tried to just go with each requirement and provide a response. I'm more than happy to read those, or you can just read them. And you know, if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer those. With these responses in mind, and after careful thought and consideration, staff has determined that the home occupation being operated out at 5310 Tucker Road does qualify, meet the intent of the home occupation, and is incidental and accessory to the principal residential use. I'll be more than happy to answer any questions.
Okay, if you would, just for the record, tell us what they can do, what they can store, what they can park by right for a home occupation. And give us those parameters to refresh our memories.
Home occupations can have up to 2 commercial vehicles as part of their occupation. They can't operate between the hours of 8 p.m. and 7 a.m. They are allowed to have storage on the property, but the storage has to be in such a manner that it can't be seen from the public right-of-way. In other words, they can build a building and put all their stuff associated with their own business inside of that accessory building. They can't have any products for sale that is visible from the street. They can use their home for administrative purposes only, meaning paperwork, phone calls, things of that nature. Traditionally, we have allowed an occupation to operate in a manner that there's no gathering on the property. It has to be just the residents involved in the occupation that can, you know, gather on the property. There is some gray area when it comes to the employees. As we understand from the complaint, the business owner does have an employee, but as we understand, the employee does not come to the property. But we receive complaints that, you know, he does have an employee. I'm not sure if the employee comes to the property. And that's a call that the zoning office has made that's okay. It can be challenged, but, you know, over time, as long as the employees doesn't come, pick up paychecks, conduct business on the property, we have customarily allowed that over the years, at least for 25 years. Those are some of the things, major things that a home occupation can do.
And again, possibly for clarification, the 2 vehicles, normally it is accepted that these are work primary vehicles as opposed to a individual personal vehicle. So that if there were 4 vehicles on the yard, 2 of which were personal vehicles and 2 of which were commercial, you can look at them and tell, this is dedicated to commercial, that would still meet, even though there were 4 vehicles, but there's only 2 of them that is business.
Yes, that is correct. In this case, I believe the business owner has some pumper trucks, flatbed trucks that he uses in the conduct of his business. He's limited to 2. We received complaints that there are more than that. From the times we went out there, we didn't see that. But there have been complaints filed in that time.
Okay.
When you go to inspect this, do you give notice that y'all will be coming?
Normally we do not. We've been advised to contact, if we're doing a site visit or investigating a complaint, us to notify the business or the property owner that we are coming out. I can say that this started several months ago. The property owner did have a number of porta potties on the property that were visible. They were lined up, they were very visible. There were about 30 to 40 of them. He has since removed those from the property.
Do we know why?
Any other questions, any discussions? And at the current time, to the best of staff and I guess maybe enforcement's determination, they appear to have whatever store there in the building that is there for the most part, and there are no porta potties anywhere that are on the site.
I don't know if any porta potties are on the site.
any other discussions? Okay. Question for Carmella, question for Lee. It's been a long time since we had an administrative decision appealed. I mean, the person that filed this has the right to come up and speak.
That's correct. Sir, and present any evidence
right.
He has.
Okay. All right, thank you very much. We may call on you again in a minute.
Sure.
Okay. Applicant, come to the lectern, give us name and address for the record, and or in this case, the representative of the
applicant. Yes, sir. My name is Colton Bryce. 1008 North Patrick Street. I'm here on behalf of Mr. and Mrs. Fielding and their similarly situated neighbors. I want to give the definition, and Carmelo did it earlier, but home occupation as defined is any business, occupation, or profession customarily conducted entirely within a dwelling and carried on by an occupant thereof, which use is clearly incidental and secondary to the use of the dwelling for residential purposes. By definition, it is to be conducted entirely within the dwelling. And here, aside from potential bookkeeping, nothing is being conducted within the dwelling. This is all outside storage, cleaning, and the whole shebang. 5.0101B points out what is essentially a default home occupation. I call it a per se home occupation. Attorneys, realtors, engineers, academic tutors, administrative or clerical support services, beauty, barbershops, pet grooming, daycare for six or fewer children, licensed medical practitioners, manufacturers' representatives, cottage industry such as cooking, creation of intellectual property, and studios for artists, photographers, or artisans. And we do understand that a home occupation is allowed by right in these areas zoned for residential. However, the fact that this section is present in the ULDC shows that there is a limitation to what can and cannot be a home occupation. 5.0101C further is what I call the catch-all provision, which allows for anything similar to these enumerated uses can be declared a home occupation. This shows the flexibility of the ULDC in its interpretations and whatnot. It allows for a use that may have not been considered at the time that it was codified to be allowed here, which shows its flexibility and its ability to bend with the times. However, it specifically states that it must the use and tasks associated with that use have to be similar to these others. As we pointed out, all of these are kind of one room in your house businesses that you conduct from your home. This is not even close to similar to any of these uses. And again, with this provision is in place to allow for flexibility, but it also provides for limitations. If anything was allowed to be a home occupation, these two sections would not be necessary because anybody running any business would be okay. The fact that these are here shows the limitations, and we strongly feel that an interpretation of these, this ULDC would limit this and exclude human waste removal business from consideration of a home occupation. Finally, there's a 5.0103A allows for agricultural home occupations, which further shows that the ULDC wants to encourage home occupations, and but again, they're limited to taxidermy, agricultural sales of products grown on the premises, tree services, woodworking, farm equipment service. And then it has the following, small businesses limited to farm products or services. And again, this small businesses, this general provision allows for a liberal interpretation of what is and is not. However, it is limited, once again, to farm products or services. And I don't think there's any dispute as to whether or not this particular business is related to any kind of farm service or farm products. Next, I'd like to get into the actual standards for the home occupation. And again, I want to stress that this section requires that all home occupations shall meet all the standards. It doesn't say that most home occupations meet the standards. It doesn't say that all home occupations have to meet most of the standards. This is absolutely has to fit all of these, or else it's not valid. Section B, employees of the home occupation shall be limited to the residence of the dweller. I believe Ms. Braswell stated earlier that while there is another employee, he may or may not visit the property. He may do so off-site. However, as the ULDC is written, and as y'all ruled back in December on the variance request, this states that the employees of the home occupation, if the home occupation is Milo's septic and porta toilets, and he is an employee of that, he is in violation of this standard, whether he meets on the property or elsewhere. And that SMS report that I gave you, as of April 29th, 2018, he still has two employees listed as employees of the business, despite the fact that that variance request was denied 4 months ago. Next, I'd like to move to Section C. The home occupation shall be clearly incidental to the residential use of the dwelling. Not only does this standard require that the home occupation be incidental to the use of residence as a dwelling, but it must be clearly incidental. And to me, that says if there's any doubt, if there's any question on whether or not this is incidental, it is not clear. It is unclear, which again goes in conflicts with the words of the ULDC. And moreover, storing 50 plus fume-producing porta potties in a proposed accessory building, as well as having multiple pump trucks in the yard, is far from incidental to the use of a dwelling for residential purposes. Section D, the use of the dwelling for home occupation shall not change the residential character of the building. This kind of goes back with C, but again, used porta potties and trucks parked in and around the yard will change the residential character of the building. If you pass by, it no longer looks like a home. It looks like a commercial business because of the big building storing the things, the big pump trucks that are in the yard. Whether you can see them or not, the residential character of this area is changed because of that. Again, in conflation with the standards. H states that the home occupation shall not constitute a nuisance to the surrounding neighborhood by use of machinery or equipment that produces noise, odor, vibration, or other objectionable conditions beyond the property line. Last meeting we had, we talked about a proposed accessory building, I believe Mr. Cawthorn stated that he planned on building a vegetative buffer to mitigate the word he used was fumes produced by these clean units. It's our opinion that if a unit was clean, it wouldn't have fumes. It's also our opinion that mitigation is not what this Section H calls for. This section says that it shall not constitute a nuisance. It does not say you put forth your best effort to keep a nuisance from crossing property lines. It states shall not. Any mitigation is irrelevant, as 1% of the fumes crossing the line is in violation of this standard. The neighbors have talked about the sound of pressure washing. They say that a pressure washer against a big plastic porta unit, porta john, makes a very distinct and unmistakable sound. This is, more than one neighbor has told me that they have heard the sound. To me, this kind of implies that the units are being cleaned on the premises, but as well as this unmistakable sound of high pressure water hitting a big piece of plastic. It's also causing noise and that crosses the property lines. Finally, K, the two commercial vehicles. Pointing back to that SMS report, the first exhibit I gave y'all, that shows that as of April 28th, there are 5 vehicles registered in Milo Sanitation. And again, there's been 4 months since that one was presented to y'all and ultimately denied, and it has not been updated on the SMS site despite the adequate time to do so. There's also been neighbors who have seen more than 2 vehicles on the property. Again, despite y'all's denial of it back in December. That's the statutory opposition we have to this decision. Next.